Going on, my friend. Hope you are well. Thank you for your patience. Let's turn this on. Okay. So I will be in share mode for most of the trading, as I prefer. I've made your initials, so everything's looking good. So let's get to it. Let's not waste any time. 0 degree Libra rising. Okay, so that means that your chart would be very similar in pole sign, as it would be in Placidus or Coach or whatever. And yet your moon in Aries and your sun in Leo. You got that trine, that nice trine, and then the sextile with the ascendant, or I guess ascendant like sign, not degree. So with Jupiter. So yeah, your big three support each other really well. Your moon squares Neptune and Uranus. Your sun's then aspected. And yeah, not that many. I just my last reading was just like literally like so many aspects. It's insane. One of the harder ones I've had to, or one of the more difficult charts, you could say. So this is like this grid was just filled with red. This one's like very empty. So, let's start with the basics. So, as the sun in Leo 11th house, it's unaspected. You're gonna be someone who really feels like, I mean, I don't really go into sun signs. It's not my thing. I'll leave that to some other astrologers, the TikTok ones. But like Leo, esoteric, from like a deeper perspective, there's the high low of everything, right? And with Leo, it's really about how about creative purpose, authentic self expression, and I already see you as a very creative person, most likely. Libra, Venus ruled chart, Venus in on the midheaven, so that's actually like art, like professional artists will have that kind of thing going on. Venus on the midheaven, especially as a chart ruler, it's a very strong Venus in Cancer, which is square by Jupiter, but that's like not even a bad square. It's like it's well, it's good. It's a really good Venus. Which is also good for self-love and relationships. But yeah, an unaspected like Leo sun means that you just gotta watch out. Where's the Black Moon Lilith? It's in Aries. Yeah, so you gotta watch out in conjunction. Okay, you gotta watch out for like the impulse, like the kind of fiery, like I don't want to say whenever I say like narcissistic like tendencies, like sometimes people get the wrong ideas, but like just watching out for like with an aspect of Leo sun, for that Leo pride and stubbornness and the all that like need for validation, which I'm not, I don't think you have. I'm just saying these are everything's potentials, right? To get out of hand. You strike me, I mean we've talked a little bit. And you strike me as a very laid back person, but sometimes these fiery people, like they have that vibe, especially when they're Libra rising, and then they've got their sun and moon fire. It comes out when you speak to them more and get to know them better. Midheaven in Cancer, which is kind of like how you're seen on social media, how you're seen by the masses, as you will. So yeah, I think that there's a the house placement of your sun is the arena of life where you're meant, where that Leo energy is meant to shine. And it's the 11th house, so it's groups of people, friends, organizations. But also I relate it more to humanitarianism and like combining forces with people, or just your overarching like big picture goals that take like a lifetime to complete. Sometimes like the 11th house person has like such a specific life purpose that it takes time and they slowly build up, and it takes time for them to really, really get to it, I guess you could say. Now, what's blocking some of that though is the Chiron and Leo in that same house, which could speak of like issues expressing, because like at its core, Leo is about the inner child, right? And when you have that there, it can be a little bit like, a lot of times it's like people who like maybe like through their upbringing had issues expressing like being that their inner child, and they have to do like inner child work where they can like allow themselves to like just be kids in the sense of just like being able to let go and let their true personality shine, that true authentic personality. So that's one thing. But just like another aspect, and let me just double check just with my eyes, because yeah, you see, my program's fucking with me. It doesn't show Pluto, which is clearly squaring the sun. Doesn't show it. Pisses me off. It's even like it's within 7 degrees. And I know how to change the orbs in this program. So you don't have an unaspected sun. Good thing I look. You have sun square Pluto. Let's get into that. That's gonna add like a very scorpion. So that's very common for people who come to me. People who get interested in spirituality and growth and transformation, especially you being, younger than me, at least by 3 years. Just entering kind of the set. Are you in your you're not quite in your Saturn return yet, are you? It's degrees there. So it's like, yeah, you're like pretty much there. Pretty much there. I mean, it's in the same sign. So yeah, Saturn return time. So of course, like that's when we grow up. That's when we get real with ourselves and with our circumstances and fully become adults, move into adulthood. And some, a lot of times it's an unexpected karmic occurrence, or like something very karmic comes up, whether it's a relationship, whether it's something with the family. You never can really tell. It's always so unpredictable. And being that you have Mars 12th house, Virgo, okay. Capricorn, Saturn. Ooh, Saturn. I mean, yeah, it's like opposite the sun, but 12-degree orb. So I'm not gonna really go and count that. I mean, although it is retrograde, yeah. But regardless, with the sun and Pluto, that square, you know, there's a big need to let go, and surrender the ego. As a Leo, it can early in life create someone who is kind of what I was saying before, like with the Leo, right? Where they might feel like a need to like control everything, and they can be over domineering. A lot of times it can come from like the father, whoever like the main like parent was. And you have the trine with your sun and moon, which typically means, you know, a good relationship with mother, between the mother and father, typically means that they're still together, and that they're, and if not, that their worldviews align to an extent. But still, sun square Pluto, you know, it's about conflict with respect to the ego, and to like maybe an over like a father that was strict or overbearing in some type of way. And what can happen when you have that is that you can project a lot of like this like need for control. And basically, yeah, there's a huge, like, it's very, very important. Like the lesson of like letting go is of utmost importance. And what can happen is that there can just basically be like this deep need for always being in control of situations, as I said, and in relation, and can have relationship implications, right? Where there can be these really, really quick bonds, right? That can lead to obsession. And sometimes the person can almost like there can be like these self limitations, self-inflicted fears, and restraints, that like are working against you. And yeah, it just makes someone very intense when it comes to like personal relationships, right? Maybe they can come off as like, quote unquote, like too much, and like, you know, you're moving in your Saturn return, so like I read charts the same. I'd read your chart the same if you were 20, 25, whatever, you know. It's all about how your free will interacts with your chart. But yeah, lots of e there can be ego conflicts, and there's it's basically like a initiation, a spiritual initiation, where you need to dive deep into yourself and really have that honest look of like, okay, like, you know, do I really need like what's my relationship with control? You know, what's my relationship with not being able to let go, right? Ego battles that come up, like how does that play out, right? Do those play out? And you know, the big thing, like one of the best things for that is to, of course, is this type of thing, you know, like psychological self-analysis through whatever means. But it does create someone who really wants to probe deeper into their shadow, and they kind of get submerged into that, just by life in general. It's this internal battle, right? And it's all about power. So there can be power tripping, but once one realizes that true power only comes from within, that's when everything changes, basically. And when you start to see that there's not a need, like it really does take like a level of mindfulness and chill, and going and really like going deep within to see like the kind of like journey into your own personal underworld, to kind of see how these tendencies might be playing out. Also, there's addiction ish potential. It's about the taboo, especially sexually, also the occult, all those things, and they all help you lead towards that transformation. But yeah, overall, it's like the sacrificing the need for control is what leads to the rebirth, the death, rebirth, transformation. And but it's not about, and it's also really, really good for success, right? And having this like this deep power and reserve to move forward. So it's not about sacrificing that. It's about learning to channel that intensity that Pluto brings into hard work and determination, right? And like being like very ambitious and even competitive, but less concerned, like competitive with yourself, you could say, but not perfectionist, right? But less concerned with like competition with other people, because sometimes people with this can like bring other people down to get to the top. So it's very important. So, and then having the moon in Aries, right? Of course, it's like the spiritual warrior placement. And you know, there's a square, you know, two squares, so Neptune and Uranus. So you know, the moon square Neptune is really difficult to have, regardless of what sign the moon is in, because it just can make someone just like so empathetic, especially with, yeah, just in general, just so empathetic, to where like they pick up on everything, you know, so they're like a sponge for energy. And it can be overwhelming, and sometimes they can just shut down, basically. So yeah, very important to know that. And and to find ways to protect yourself spiritually, right? I think that the one with Uranus, moon square Uranus, and also like psychologically, like with Neptune, it can create a lot of fog and confusion around your emotions and what's yours and what's someone else's. So there is a need to retreat, spend time alone, and journal or do whatever you do that enables you to kind of separate your thoughts, because you can literally, if you're like around a group of people too much, like you'd be very, very influenced by them. And especially with respect to the mother, people who have this, like, can have a tendency to, I guess you could say, like let's say like the mother, like there's something with the mother, right? Like some baggage, they can sometimes like claim that as their own. And it's like this huge evolutionary points reach when they realize like, that's not mine, that's my mother's, you know? And with Uranus, it's the planet of rebellion, right? So when your moon is square Uranus, it can kind of create like a rebel without a cause at times. Now it does create someone who's very who's definitely not going to just like give in to like what society, how society says you should be, and it'll make someone, more eccentric and individualistic, and a great need for freedom in personal relationships and just in general. However, one of the risky things, well, risk. You have to watch out for like, taking too many risks. That's one thing. And like doing things that it's almost like you're doing them just like, let's say, like, give an example, like, let's say like your parents or someone like society is telling you to do this, or like someone's telling you to do something that's actually good advice. There could be a tendency for someone with this to just, even if it's good advice, to go against it. So to be like overly rebellious to the point to where it's like, it's not, it's like, it's so there's a need to like look at that objectively at every situation, and then determine through logic what the right approach is. But overall, it just makes someone who, who can have also like rapid mood swings and also lots of impulsive reactions. On a really good side, like it can be very, very psychic, both of these, right? It can give you like the Neptune already spoke about how you can be very in touch with like the collective unconscious, which sometimes can be overwhelming, and people with this sometimes lots of fire people can sometimes smoke too much of the green stuff, because it's just like they can have issues, especially Aries moon can have anger issues, so they can have issues with emotional regulation. So it's like meditation and finding ways to calm yourself down, very important. And yeah, there's also like with the Uranus, like this need for like this extra excitement, and there can be like this grass is greener on the other side kind of energy, and very, very independent, right? So like they can be like, yeah, drawn to anything new and shiny, and easily distracted. There can be like issues with like paying attention. So like learning this to sit with yourself and really kind of ground your energy is very important. But it does make one very open-minded, someone who can change their approach in general, and very exciting. You want to live a life that's like filled with like fun and exciting and changeable, like changeability, right? But yeah, it, like for like more like traditional types of people, there can be like a clash. And yeah, like very like it's really important to become like aware of your emotional compulsions, and yeah, and find like a, with your Pluto in the second house, like find like a strict like moral code that you base your actions on. Also, the moon Uranus, where people tend to move a lot. Maybe as a child they moved around, but they have no problem like moving, and they enjoy it. It's almost like an emotional need, like for something new to switch things up, and like in relationships, you'll be very independent, and you'll like cleanliness will be like you'll be allergic to it. You'll throw up. So it doesn't mean that you don't want a secure and nice relationship. I mean, you got your Venus in Cancer. However, and your Juno is in Virgo. So yeah, like there is in Mars and Virgo. So there is like a deep, desire for that really, really close spiritual relationship with someone. based on like deep emotions, and also really based on consistency. Someone who you can really rely on to be that same person day after day and really, really trust. That's like the Juno is like your ideal partner, right? It's over here in Virgo. But like a lot of times there's like an unorthodox, maybe like a like sometimes I see this like coming like a, like the mom or the parents are like hippies, or like kind of like a kind of more bohemian upbringing, you could say. But yeah, there's just this tendency to become like but also like there can be like having experienced the mother as being like a little bit emotionally detached. It's usually the mother, at least. So in relationships, like, you can become bored easily, basically, you know? So there's a need to have like that deep intellectual connection with someone, and to have someone who's exciting, but not like who's not like, but who's still like your rock, who you still can depend on when it comes to the end, at the end of the day. And you know, if you have kids or have kids or whatever, you have fifth house Saturn, so maybe you'll have kids soon. Just joking, kind of. Well, fifth house Saturn, like it would usually hold the kids off until after, you know, Saturn return or after. So I don't know, but there's other things with fifth house Saturn also. But it's there can be a struggle to balance like emotional nurturing, and the attachment and independence, which is a theme in your chart. Like one part really wanting that nurturing, and the other part wanting that independence, attachment. So it's about finding that balance. And what else can I say about that? Probably interested in technology, just humanitarianism in general, psychology, sciences, anything that's stimulating. Like you need a career that is stimulating to you, right? Even being someone who like is like a homemaker, right? Could that's like something you could see with that. And let me take a look at something here. Okay, yeah. Now I'm like, I have to like look into this. Like it lied to me already. And it lied to me again. It lied to me again. So you have a T. One sec. No. You have Mercury in Cancer, opposite Uranus and Neptune also, which creates what? A T square between ba ba ba, which shoots out in Libra, right around your Jupiter. Now in ascendant, so why is that significant? Well, so when we get further into and also one other thing about Moon and Neptune, it's just like yeah, the need to find creative outlets, because there can be like escapism tendencies. Like it's super important that I re-say that, like, because like you need to have like fantasy. There's an emotional need to have fantasy play out in your life, fantasy and imagination. But and of course, like your relationship with your mother is like super, super important. I already talked about that. But and like I want to even take it further to say that Moon square Neptune people, like how their mother nurtured them, it's more important than anyone else. If it was positive, amazing. If it was negative, it could have bad consequences, right? You're so sensitive to like the non-verbal cues as a kid, and there's like telepathy, like psychic abilities of this, right? So if there's any negativity early on with a mother, it would have shaped your life, and it's about like separating from that. But like the fact that your sun and your moon are trining each other, which is very nice, it makes me think that they probably they, that that there wasn't like anything like really bad, because a lot of times it's like, you know, like if your son was squaring your moon, for example, maybe like I'd be like, okay, shit, there's probably a divorce and the parents were like fighting and that could have really fucked you up. But like, no, like it's a trine, so it's probably it could be very good, but you still have to watch out for things like drugs, alcohol, gambling, all that stuff, right? But the key to that is expressing your emotions in a very honest way. I always say with Neptune, film yourself or use mirrors. Neptune's ruled by that, so like do like a daily vlog or a vlog, like just like film yourself on camera talking. You don't have to show anyone, like you're like a YouTuber who's just like talking about your emotions, talking about your dreams, dream journaling, all that stuff. Super important to have that connection between your imagination, dream world, and your real life. And also sharing your suffering with you know someone or someone that you trust is so important. And I think the moon Neptune person is a natural storyteller or a natural dreamer, so they are extremely artistic, and that shows with your midheaven in Venus, which can make you someone who either is an artist for a living or who, you know, Venus plays a large role into your career. You know, you have lots of love energy in your daily life. So yeah, and if there's any shyness, like I said, it gets overcome by the whole camera trick. And it can make privacy very important, but it's important to get past that. Important to get past that and to move into a place where you're able to like really express yourself. Now, speaking about expression, Mercury in Cancer, okay, they like to they speak from the emotions, right? They speak from the you know they like to speak their heart, right? They like to speak their truth, right? Which you know your moon is Aries, so it's interesting because that's a square, right? Yeah. Not by it's not a square by degree, but like it is by element. And like the Mercury in Cancer is very different than the moon in Aries, and it can create like a disconnect between mind and between like the mental cognitive part of you and the emotional, the logic and the emotional. So finding that balance, right, is important. And I think like the resolution is through something creative, you know, like having your Jupiter in and if you're like a counselor or something like that, that would be amazing, because Jupiter like or like Libra is also like the diplomat, the counselor, the person that sees both sides, the judge, you know, all that stuff. Also good for business. Yeah, and of course fire being very good for business and leadership as well. But the Aries moon, you know, emotionally independent, emotionally like pioneering, like an emotional need for action, adventure, movement forward. Nothing can keep them down. But then yeah. So with the Mercury in Cancer, like yeah, it's very sweet. But then it wants to express itself in that way. But then the Aries moon, it can be a little bit not violent, but it can be harsh. And when you have Black Moon Lilith also in Aries, which is, you know, speaking about like your kind of lower tendencies, like or tendency, like where you go to when you're at your lowest, I guess you could say. Like at your lowest vibe. One second. So yeah, it's like it's just like it's important to track to really like be grounded. And Aries moons, like Black Moon Lilith in Aries, can be a bully, like at the lowest. It can be a bully, or not even that, it can be someone who just like is too impulsive and who doesn't think enough before they act. and gets themselves into trouble because of that exact reason. Let's see. So Mercury opposite, so this is more psychic, intuitive, like very highly spiritual abilities. Already Mercury in a water sign is very good for that on its own. But like, yeah, you like to express yourself in like a more calm way, a more soothing way. You have a soothing voice, soothing energy, when it comes to speaking, which could be very good for writing and anything related to communication. And the oppositions though with Uranus, that can make you like a genius, like in the sense of not IQ. Not that it wouldn't be IQ. I don't like, it's just that I don't like defining genius in that, in those terms. I like defining it as someone who thinks outside the box. And where's your Chiron? And okay, yeah, I already said that. Like you probably are and were someone who just thought different, especially growing up, and maybe, you know, being a Leo, which is very like, you know, Leos are cool. Leos are popular, right? With a Libra rising, which is also popular, or you know, popular slash, you know, it's someone who can, and it's not, you know, there's no bad aspects. I mean, Mars, yeah, no bad aspects to the ascendant. It's like, you know, like people might not understand some things about like the way they might expect you to be a way you're not. And so okay, let's go with Mercury Uranus. It's like, okay, yeah, like Mercury Uranus is the person who thinks outside the box, who thinks ahead, who's futuristic, and who's basically inventive, you know, who has but like at the same time, it gives such a lightning fast intellect. So it could be a genius, honestly, but they can also be like a prankster, a trickster, very, very rebellious. And it creates for the mind a great, an extreme need for stimulation. That's why I can talk. Now I'm realizing like I'm like my brain, I mean, you follow me, I have the Kazemi, so like I have to like with readings calm myself down a little bit because like my brain can move just like a like very, 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 very fast. So now with you, like I know I can like speak at whatever fucking rate, but I still like to kind of like ground my sentences, you know, so they land better and not just like just fucking blah. But you do have that, you know. But yeah, so this goes back to the same energy as the moon. It's like that great need for stimulation, which can lead to issues, right? So a career wise, something that keeps you mentally busy. But there can also be you know, arguments, controversies. So you need work that's very challenging, but that also gives you tons of freedom, right? So like even like something like science, like math, anything with technology, media, like those are things that would be good. Anything like being an inventor of some sort, you know, someone who has an idea and takes it forward. That's, yeah, very original thinking style, discovering things. But yeah, getting your message across is what needs refinement. So it's another one where like the internet can be very, very good for you. Like understanding technology, and there's another need to like to learn to listen, to learn to sit back and to ground your energy and to listen, to truly listen to other people. Which in my times I've talked to you, which I'm trying to forget, I try not to know anything about the client. Like I feel like I really felt like a cancer vibe from you. Which is interesting because it rules your chart and it Well, the Venus, it's in your Venus is in Cancer, it rules your chart, it's on an angle. So it's a very strong Cancer Venus, and you have your Mercury there too. But yeah, I felt that vibe. But I could have been feeling like the Libra too, you know, that chillness, like the good Libra, the chill Libra. But yeah, it goes back to like that same thing of like you can be very opinionated and sometimes like so rebellious with your ideas where you might just like always be playing a devil's advocate, you know? And like taking the opposite opinion. So it can bring lots of critics. It can also make someone like lean into like conspiracy theories. I hate using that word. Just really a truth seeker, right? And make you really like to be with people who are also very authentic. And you want to meet people from like different backgrounds culturally. And you want to always have your mind be stimulated, right? Traveling could be great too. So also like with just like if you're working in any industry where there's like documents, it's really important to like always like double check that, like the fine print. And you know, like with any of your technology, just like a car, like regular, like with your car, for example, like regular car servicing, just making sure that things are like with technology, like there can be things that come up. But yeah, it's a nice one. I think when it's integrated, it's like, you know, and you're not shaming yourself for having like a future oriented mind. I mean, come on, you're born 93, you're from the Bay, right? The Bay, I think. Fontana. And your into astrology, it's dope. Props to you, my friend. So yeah, that's kind of an Aquarian vibe to your Mercury, right? And then the Neptune adds kind of a Pisces vibe to it, right? This gives you like an amazing creative imagination. But like it can also like make like so this is a tricky one, right? And my girlfriend has this square, and I see it all the time, like where she just doesn't see things correctly. Like she reads situations wrong, but then she thinks that she's reading them right, but she's not. And sometimes she's super on point, but sometimes she's way off of people's intentions and gets really paranoid and about things that she shouldn't be, you know, stuff like that. So it's really important to like have someone that like to first like is to have that the awareness of that potential. And then to have something that you can lean on and be like, hey, like this is how, or like in a relationship, for example, like, you know, there can be like misunderstandings. You'd be like, hey, like I interpreted, like this is how, like I interpreted what, like your action or like you know, how you've been, like, am I correct or am I tripping? You know? But like, it can make you really, really good with like with the high mind and understand like super high abstract spiritual like concepts. But then with like the basic shit, like putting together like a fucking IKEA couch, it can be like difficult or something, you know? Or even just more like basic communication. So it's like, yeah, basically like there's like a the lens through which you process information is different. And yeah, like so there can be like oversensitivity to your environment, which can be confusing. So that goes back to the need for time alone. If you're around someone for too long, you might like merge your thoughts with them. So important to kind of like for you just like to just like you know, take time alone and move into a place where you can like let's say you're with someone for a long time and you feel a certain type of way. Move away from them and then start writing, right? Journaling. Because your north node's in the third house. So like you're meant to like get into your throat chakra or communication. In Sagittarius, right? So like writing about your philosophies is very it could be very important for you. And just like writing about like how you feel now that you're away from them and you'll gain greater insight into them. But yeah, once again, this is another one where you can just be bombarded by too much psychic like information and the mind can't filter out the background noise, right? So it can be very confusing and lead to miscommunication. Deceptions and lying, stay the fuck away. Do not lie. Like, you will get caught. Sorry, I said this Coke. Or it's actually a botanical pop cola, botanical. It tastes literally better than Coca-Cola. So fucking good. Yeah, like the big thing with this one for me is always like in relationships, it's like just like how there can be mistrust and suspicion and just like not seeing someone's intention correctly. And but also being like vulnerable to deception and being ripped off and abused, like in just in general. Like, so just really like having like that solid person you can call on, or just like developing that yourself. Like the like literally with this, it's just all about the conscious awareness and acceptance of that flaw. And that will go a long way. You know, and I already talked to you about like the double checking, asking like in psychology with the reality checking, hey, this is how I experienced it. Like, what's like what was your intention type thing? And yeah, asking for advice when you need it, you know, a second opinion. It's like asking for second opinion, so true. And also like when it comes to like different conspiracy theories and things like that, like you know, just not like believing, obviously, like you know this, like you know, just like really like seeing all sides of the story, because there can be a tendency to like believe the one that's more further than the mainstream. But tons of famous like artists have this, by the way, just so you know. It's also good, yeah, for politics, oddly enough. Okay. So then we see here, so yeah, moon in Aries, that we talked about that. Seventh house, so there's emotional need for relationships. So you have to watch out for codependency, especially the Libra rising, people pleasing, but there's gonna be this like this need to balance out Libra and Aries, which is like being too Aries is like being too, it's all like not like being too like I'm not willing to sacrifice anything for, you know, the other person, and being too Libra is like codependent. Having your moon in the seventh house can be a little bit like watch out for codependency type shit. Let's see. And yeah, but like having Jupiter in the first house, beauty, pure beauty. I mean, it's just great. And so in Libra, so it's gonna give you this amazing ability to, it's very good for attraction, like energetic attraction, like where people just feel drawn to your energy. You have a very good energy. And I feel that like in the few times that we've, you know, communicated, like I felt like your vibe is super fucking like on point and chill. But with the, you know, the seventh house moon, it's like you gotta watch out for and black moon with the seventh house too, for being too much relationship oriented. And yeah, just like finding that balance between compromise and finding the compromise balance, basically. Between compromising but not compromising, like your need for independence, your need for being your own person. And yeah, in past lives, you know, like okay, so yeah, you have this thing that a lot of astrologers don't know how to answer, but I do, because you've got your North Node in Sag in the house of Gemini, and your South Node in Gemini in the house of Sag. Used to be a head scratch for me. I was like, what the fuck does it mean? But then I figured it out. Just sipping on that cola. Let me think for a second. Let my mind ponder something. Yeah, okay. I see. So, yeah, basically, like the axis of Sag Gemini has been imbalanced for you in past lives. And basically, in this life, it's about the mind. Karmically, you're trying to figure out how you can take the highest of Gemini and the highest of Sag and put them together. So, Gemini is basically the journalist. But like low Gemini, right, which your south node is in Gemini, is the person who is too in the gossip and too in the here and now, and it's too all over the place. It's like starts like a thousand things and doesn't really finish any of them. So it's about being very curious, but not to the point to where it's like bad, you know, like being curious, but not to the point to where it's like you're just like starting something and not finishing it. And that's another thing with having that much fire, right? Is that tendency can exist. To just like want to like oh, I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna take that, I'm gonna take this on this on that, blah 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 blah. And then you go back to the Libra, right? Which and we're gonna talk about your Mars and Virgo, of course. You know, you've seen me write about that one in the 12th house too. But yeah, there can be people pleasing tendencies, right? So you gotta really watch out for, okay, so we're talking about two different axes, right? Axes here, Aries, Libra, and Gemini, Sag. So yeah, like really really like finding a way to kind of like not people please and to not but it's an Aries moon, usually that's difficult, but it's in the seventh house, you see? So it's like as a Libra rising, everything gets twitched up. That's the craziest part about Libra rising. It's one of the most like interesting rising signs because everything gets flipped. Everything gets flipped from where from it like if that makes sense. Like because the first house is usually Aries, right? And the seventh house is the first house is ruled by Aries, and the seventh house is ruled by Libra, right? But in your chart, your first house is Libra, and your seventh house is Aries. So every single, and then usually the second is Taurus, and the eighth is Scorpio, and yours second is Scorpio, and the eighth is Taurus. So everything gets flipped. So it's like you see all these different perspectives, right? Very interesting. Now, as I was saying, and of course your sun is at 15 degrees, so it's like the Gemini degrees. So it's like there is that very perceptive mind, that mind that really wants to like comprehend and go out and experience a lot, and community is very important to you. But yeah, there's definitely a need to his brain froze. Definitely a need to kind of like not be okay, so not be in the low Gemini, which is simply put. What I was saying before, right? About like what just happened? Something just happened. Am I tripping? Hold on. Stop share. Okay. Thank God. Share screen. Okay, we're back. So, yeah, like basically, like Gemini, like just the tendency to like to be too in the here and now, too in the immediate environment, not taking it, like North Node's in Sag, like you're meant to travel, you're meant to experience different cultures, you're meant to take risks when it comes to like, you know, to opening yourself up to new philosophies. Now also, because the South Node's in the ninth house, we have to talk about low Sag and high Sag, right? And how these two get added together. Essentially, low Sag is like, I know it all. So like, it's like coming into the life with like this like dogmatism, right? Like, I know it all, like, you know, my way, like, you know, what I know is the truth, and fuck you. So like high Sag is like, I'm open. I just want to learn, you know, I just want to experience, like the gypsy starts as a gypsy, turns into the teacher who turns into the philosopher. It's like the Stephen Forrest, the author, like his like archetypal explanation of it. So it's really about like the Gemini part, like being a journalist, but not on like a low level where there's like, you know, gossip, deceit, lying, all that. You know how like and just like back and forthness, like two sidedness. A journalist of life. But then being able to take that and take all of the data that you've collected and put it in and then create truth. Like create, like Sagittarius is all about the truth. It's all about finding like the truth you connect to. Yeah. It's all about tying the Gemini in like data, right? Like so you, like you know how like a journalist or a researcher like goes out, gets data, that's Gemini. Sag is when they put it all together. So it's very important to do that. To do that shit. Yeah. So that's kind of the mission, right? Is to do, and then low Sag, yeah, and to not be dogmatic and to not enter situations and think that your way, like just being open to hear, even if you're like, this person's so full of you know, like, you know what I mean? Like, even if you're like, so like, you're like, okay, like just being open to like hearing what someone has to say and how they might view things can go a long way. So yeah. And okay, so Mars, we're gonna talk about Mars. Okay. So Mars in the 12th house, that is difficult in Virgo. And it is unfucking aspected. Jesus, okay, let's double check that. Yep. Got some unaspected Mars and it's 12th in Virgo. Okay, so this is where it gets difficult for you. That's a very difficult place for my friend. Now, how difficult? Okay, it's not that. It's not like fucking, like your chart isn't so hard, like to the point to where it's like, you know, like it's unbearable. But you know the thing with Mars and Virgo, it's just about over, like it can create someone who is very overly critical of themselves. And basically with the moon square Venus or square Neptune, excuse me, there's the potential of not seeing yourself clearly, right? So yeah, being able to really kind of like being able to like that, it can basically just like it's one of like the ultimate like self deception, like just self sabotaging placements, Mars in 12th house. People like have that a lot of times. They just do shit, and then I'm like, they're like, after they're just like, why the fuck did I do that? And then you have an Aries Mars with like Leo in Aries, so it's like that can speak to that tendency, of being impulsive. So it's really important to really really think before you do shit. Sleep on it, sleep on it. And yeah, like Mars and Virgo, really, really good for lots of things, like being precise, like being very, very observant. But they can be the kinds of people when it's unintegrated or in a shadow position. And the key to solving this, or to like to not solving, but to like manifesting it in the highest way, is service, being of service in your life. But like the thing is, you do have it rising, so it's 2 degrees from your rising, so it's like nearly a first house Mars. It's like it's interesting, like when it's that close to the ascendant, 2 degrees away, it's like it does make you like more assertive. Yeah, but basically, there's just a need to see that tendency. And watch out for, really watch out for perfectionism, because it can get projected. So people who have that, sometimes like no one's ever good enough for them, you know, or they just find faults in everything themselves. So they really, really need to like have like learn self-compassion, or else like sometimes. And like the rest of your chart doesn't really support like the lower side of this that much, right? Because it is Earth. So like in your case, it could be a good thing, because that's the only Earth you have. So it could actually be a grounding force, but it is in the 12th house. So just like leaning into it in a way to where like you're like, okay, like I want to have like the highest energy of that is like having like a spiritual like routine, if that makes sense. Yeah, like a spiritual routine. And yeah, and just like really be, like it's everything is about in your chart, it's all about awareness, you know, like it's all about awareness. So like being aware of that potential tendency, right? And don't get me wrong, I met people with Mars and Virgo who are not like this. Maybe my brother has it, so like, and he has definitely the lower manifestation, and so like, but like he also has like a Capricorn moon. So it's like, you know what I mean? So it's like you have to take everything into the whole chart into consideration, but yeah, like just noticing like physical observations, like being very physically observant, oh, you're looking kind of fat, you know, or like, oh, no, I'm not saying like my brother's saying this, I'm just like an example, like, oh, like your room's dirty, you know. So and there can be like, yeah, like a tendency to like be OCD and nitpicky and stuff like that. So it's just like the highest energy is just like being of service, and using that Virgo energy, that can, because it makes you, this actually adds like a lot of consistency to you, which is, it's needed when you don't have any Earth. So it can actually be a good thing. But 12th house is a very spiritual house, so it's like either it's like you can use it to like get deeper into spirituality, and to kind of like how you say it, to kind of, yeah, deep, like to deepen yourself, and yeah, deepen yourself, and just like know about that tendency. I'm trying to think what else I can say. Well, maybe more will come. But yeah. Is oh yeah, it's unaspected. That's what I was gonna say. So that means that it's not held back at all. So that whole tensei I just spoke about can just like go full on. So it can make you very, very successful and very, very assertive and very action oriented, right? Where you just take action. But there can be some recklessness with an aspect in Mars. You really have to check yourself. Okay. And then the Venus, like I said, it's beautiful, well placed. Beauty, lots of like beauty in your career. Now you do have 0 degrees for every single angle, which is super interesting. Ascendant zero, MC, IC, and descendant. I've never ever seen that because they're not all linked, right? Like the MC, like the ascendant and the descendant are always opposites, but they're not like the same degrees that I see the MC. So to have them all at 0 degrees, you see, wait, this makes no sense. 0.01. Like, look, I'll show you my chart. Like, you see my ascendant 27. It's wrong. It's somehow it says 27.59. It's literally not. I don't know what the fuck. If I pull up on any other site, it's like 28. I don't know. It like changed, but basically, you see how like 27 here, and then I see 22, right? So like for you, it's not. It's like literally exactly the same, which is wild. It's 0.01 and 0.01. So that is just insane. And basically, it just means that like there's like it's like a very, very new karmic beginning for you in this lifetime. And your Pluto at 22 degrees is also like, an interesting one. It can create lots of restrictions. Saturn degree Pluto, maybe around money. There's lots of karmic lessons to be learned around money. There's most likely past incarnations where you spent it in survival mode. You think of the hierarchy of needs, right? Food, shelter, all this. So like when someone has this, it's like a lot like when they weren't really able to like do that thing that I talked about, like with your north node, like with the higher mind, the lower mind, like connect, like really like pushing the mind forward, the intellect and whatnot, because they were stuck in survival mode. But also creates lots of like trauma around money. Sometimes they come from like a poor family, and yeah, just making it can be difficult. And even when they do make it, sometimes they always have this like fear, and I've seen this a lot, like this fear that like they're gonna run out. Like, so I've literally seen millionaires, multi-millionaires, who are afraid to like buy a new bed. It's insane. Or an uncle of mine who grew up, they weren't poor, but they're pretty poor. Like, I mean, they grew up on a farm, so they all had to bust their asses. And my brother has like my dad has five siblings, and they've all done very well for themselves, just based off pure grit and determination, right? But one of my uncles, he has this, and he buys like broken houses and just like builds them himself, like rebuilds everything, and then he I think he probably has like 10 to 15 that he's like bought for like nothing, and they're like legit fucking beautiful houses now in France, like in Brittany, right? And it's not really France, it's in France, but we have our own Celtic culture and whatnot. So the point I'm trying to make is that there's lots of karmic lessons around money, and yeah, like there can basically that. And there can be like an obsession to like to make so much of it and to want to like overpower and you know it goes with your square with your sun. To just like want to overpower and just make so much, but it's all about finding that power within yourself, and that's where the real where the real growth comes from is where you find that really solid grounding within yourself. So moving forward, moving forward. Yeah, so I would also like say like with spending, I mean Venus in Cancer isn't like you know it's not like crazy in that respect, but you know it does square Jupiter, so I would say like watch out for taking risks, like if you do gamble or do anything like that, like just like watch out for like taking like too many like risks and being over expansive, in that area. Also with love, just taking things too far in Venus ruled areas, basically. But like, it can be a great thing if you're an artist, you know? So yeah. Okay, what have we not talked about before we go to the stars and asteroids? Oh yeah, Saturn in the fifth house. And then okay, and the, yeah. So basically, like, right now, like your life's gonna become a lot more fun. You're gonna be able to like open yourself up a lot more. In a sense of like in the sense of Saturn fifth house people sometimes like it's very good for like making your the things you do for fun your like your job, but sometimes they just like they need to do inner child work because they weren't like because of their circumstances growing up they had to step into a role early and they weren't really able to grow up, you know, to really like be a kid. So important. And that's gonna, you know, and if you do want to do further readings with me, which most people do, the only people who don't usually it's like if it's like a financial constraint, like it's I think you got the reading in the follow-up, I'm pretty sure. If you did, which I'm gonna switch to, actually I'm gonna do that in a sec, but yeah, like 1 second, yeah. So okay, I'm gonna actually check that real quick. So when nearly everyone does. Yeah, you get the follow. Yeah. Is and I would do it for it's usually like 300 something. I would do it for you for 230. It instead of just getting the follow-up, which you already have paid for, it's getting the follow-up and current astrology, where I'm diving into like the current energies for you right now. And it can be very, very interesting. And yeah, you like I have tons of predictive techniques, and that reading is a live one. I recorded, but I only sent to you privately. And you know, it's like 3 hours. Like first hour is like the follow up, and then but it can go longer. I did one the other day. It was like nearly 4 hours. Shit, way too long. But anyways, but like with you and your Saturn return, like I also do like current astrology with the Saturn return. Chart. That could be something you might be interested in potentially. And that one I would do for 250, which it's usually like a lot more. So yeah. So yeah, then when we talk about like, you know, Neptune in the fourth house, there can be like someone who like doesn't have like a firm memory of their childhood. Like they literally just like can't remember it, or they either like under idealize it or over idealize it, if that makes sense. But like there's like some fog around seeing it for what it really was. And Uranus, fourth house, it's like a lot of times it's like someone who had to like move around a lot, or who had like a very like kind of, like I said, like unconventional upbringing. Not necessarily a bad thing, just like, you know, maybe it helped them become like more authentic and whatnot. So yeah. And okay, yeah, so then yeah, Chiron, I talked about like how there could be like pain, like friends and groups and organizations and all that, like are in like are such a huge thing for you, but like there could have been like lots of like pain that you had to go through in that realm. So yeah, that can be rough. That can be rough for sure. But it's about overcoming that and being someone who can be a part of groups, like, you know, the one you're in, and who can contribute and who can really like be themselves in groups that are, you know, very authentic to them, like where there's like that real authentic like kind of connection between you and the group, and like the people in it and whatnot. So okay. Vertex, seventh house, yeah, and also like with a 0 degree, like, you know, ascendant, like there can be like a level of like naivete. You just really have to watch out for like people like trying to trick you and shit, and like being naive, right? You have to kind of watch out for that. And I saw that with the Neptune energy already too. Okay. Oh fuck. And yeah, your descendants in Aries, so like, you know, once again, you'll be attracted to, you know, your moon sign in Aries, like someone who's independent and someone who's also fun and who is forward moving, but also like, you know, I already went into that, like your rock, someone who's like your rock and who is all, yeah, probably like a, someone who's definitely someone who's spiritual. Like I would really, really like think someone who's spiritual and who you can kind of who can help you with this North Node journey, who's like you really have a connection, a meant like a feel like a philosophical, like kind of like intellectual connection with them. That's massive. Massive, massive. And aside from that, what you think? Has been stopped. Stop buying my. Oh, man. Go ahead, man. Yeah. So then, okay, where's Ceres? Ceres is in the blah, blah, blah house of. Is that Ceres? Yeah. In Taurus. So, eighth house. So you feel. You nurture people by like touch and things, or you know, anything related to the senses. And you also enjoy that. And then also through anything related to the esoteric. So these are areas of experience slash life that you know, like in the whole death, rebirth, transformation thing I always talk about, right? Like that's an area for you where, you know, you kind of kill it, you kill it in that shit, you kill it in that area. Like you I'm just joking, but you feel very nurtured when there's a level of depth to whatever relationship you're in or what have you. Lots of nurturing comes from that. And yeah, just like engaging the senses is important. Very important. And what else can I say about that? And yeah. Part of fortune, eighth house in Taurus, it's like you find lots of joy when you're going through that real like death, rebirth, transformation that I keep talking about with the Pluto, you know, and spirituality and all that. Lots of joy. That's kind of like your flow state. And in Taurus, it's like when you find like heaven on earth in yourself, that groundedness. That is massive, massive, massive. So okay. Why don't I just flip. Give me 1 second. I'm gonna flip this on in a sec. Hold on, I need like 2 seconds. Okay. So, you also have Eris on your moon, so that just adds more like of that like Aries explosiveness, like just like volcanic explosiveness potential to your moon and potential issues with anger. So my girlfriend has that, and I've had the pleasure of experiencing that time to time. It's fucking awesome, not so yeah, definitely is a source of potential very high positive energy, but also the opposite. So that's been a theme. Okay, so moving forward, let's just turn the camera on. Okay, so. Okay. So yeah, basically, let's see. With Vesta, where's Vesta at? Were you at Vesta? Right here. So Vesta in the sixth is just like a commitment to serving others in what sign? It's in Pisces. Wow. So that's like about like how you work best when you're striving to like help humanity and making the world like a better place. And you can feel very overwhelmed by work unless you're really like being of service to others, pretty much, right? And yeah, it can it's like a placement of a healer. And then you have Pallas right there, conjunct it in Pisces, also in the sixth house. Pisces Pallas is like the third eye. In the six, yeah, so it kind of it can make one very good at like creating schedules and having like a good organized approach to daily life, but also like it can create like a very, well, my fucking shit was about to die if I saw that. It can create a very gifted healer. So that's really good. And in Pisces, it's like a very like it's just like the third eye is open, very meditative, open third eye. Merging, your mind with the universe, and it's like a healer energy, right? And also amazing for art, anything artistic. I already talked about Juno and Sirius; those are all the asteroids. And yeah, like with the Pluto second house, it's like the challenge. Can also be like about exploring the link between changing possessions and changing inner values. Just add that in there. Also, there can be like a strong, like with the Jupiter and Libra, like a strong concern for justice. Like, something I want to add in. Yeah, just like Libra risings are can be a little bit indecisive sometimes, and they can create sometimes have a lot of their life purpose connected to relationships, so make sure not to have too much. And like they spend a lot of time thinking about like the needs of other people, so it's like watch out to not people please. Yeah. Like very diplomatic and justice oriented, so forth. Okay, let's open up some, see if we see any of these bad boys. Okay. Let's see, what the fuck is this? So union is interesting. It represents marriage. I don't know if I would use this in a. In this context, like maybe just in synastry. Yeah, I don't know. Is it? Oh, it's because it's showing the wrong ones. I see. It's showing my relationship ones. Right? Because regulus. No, maybe not. Okay. Okay, so maybe Mars ascendant. Jupiter and Pluto can be like a major flirt. Also, you have Serpentis and Pluto. Damn. That's like where you really gotta watch your shadow. That could also just be like all about like alchemy and magic. But yeah, like just gotta watch the ego a lot. And kind of the lower vibes of Scorpio and the stuff we talked about earlier. But it can also just be like very, very magical. And then Cupido is like about like flirtatiousness, so it can make one very flirtatious and seductive. I don't judge the nodes with stars. FYI. Okay, nothing here. Because they're not actual planets, so it's like, how does it make sense? Okay. Anything in the mid-heaven besides Venus? What the fuck is this little thing? No. What the fuck is that? I swear. Oh, I see. It's 0.15. Well, Beetlejuice is 28. Yeah, it's 28.39. So different signs, though. It's still like, would that be used? Yeah, it's really good for invention, ingenuity, like for your career, perfection, like perfections of arts and sciences. It's good for sports too. Really good for like luck, success, and everlasting, yeah, just success. It's a really good one to have. Beetlejuice is like one of the money, good for money. Okay, none there, none there. And none there. So that is it. I hope you enjoyed. So let me know about if you want to do just the follow-up or if you want to do both combined, how I suggest doing both combined. And it was a pleasure. And talk soon. Ciao.